The difficulty of time travel shows isn't limited to manipulating rules and playing with physics. When a character travels to the past, they have to actually be in that moment with all of its cultural implications and politics.
So when I got to the room and it was like the 60s Dallas, my immediate go-to in my mind is like, so our characters, you know, they can drop into the 60s and possibly, you know, fit in. So that's a very different story for Allison, right? You know, this is a Black woman in the 60s and they're in like the South. So for me, immediately, we have to talk about this somehow. Like her experience is just different from her siblings.
From the moment I was told that, you know, for the second season, we are going to place you right in the middle of the civil rights movement. And I was like, I love that. I am scared of that in a good way. My name is Emmy Raver Lampman, and I play Allison Hargreaves on The Umbrella Academy.
I heard a rumor that I blew your minds.
Allison, also known as Rumor, is a celebrity sister of the Academy. She's a successful actress whose power is convincing people to do what she wants. At the end of the first season, Allison has her throat slashed by her sister, Vanya, which presents her with one very big challenge right at the start of season two.
She has no voice. She cannot speak. And I think because of that, it forces her kind of to start over, to reinvent herself without powers. And I think it is less complicated life for her, and it is simpler, and it is truer and more real.
One of the ways the writers thought Allison could reinvent herself was to relearn how to use her voice. She did that both physically and metaphorically by becoming part of the civil rights movement. The writers worked with the researcher to make sure their scripts were accurate, but they also did a lot of their own digging. When it came time to capture the bravery of Black civil rights activists and the violence they faced, they decided to put the sit-ins of the 1960s on the screen.
Else I'm calling the police.
I'd like to be served, please.
Can't you read, girl?
Seven languages.
Oh, you smart one, huh?
So, Emmy, what was the first scene you shot for the sit-in?
I'm pretty sure we shot it in order, actually. Stephen Sergic, who is just amazing, and he directed a few episodes on the first season as well. I think it was really important to him that we shoot it in order so that we were all on the ride together and we weren't skipping around. And so the first scene that we did shoot is, you know, me walking in, sitting down, and then the beautiful scene in slow motion where everybody else kind of follows me in and then they all sit down.
We'd like to be served, please.
One by one, the members of the movement sit at the lunch counter. The white customers get up from their tables. Some are simply horrified. Others are looking for a fight.
You are not welcome here.
As the night progresses, the white customers get more and more belligerent, pouring salt on the protesters' heads. There are other Black protesters outside the diner yelling, "No more back door." White police officers stand by their cars, with their clubs out and at the ready.
It was like the end of the first night of shooting this sequence when the police officer like slams my face into the counter, and then I had to watch Ray get beat up.
Ray is Allison's husband in the show, played by actor Yusuf Gatewood.
And, you know, that was extremely difficult and really just heartbreaking. And you know, you could feel it in the room because, you know, there was 50 plus extras and background actors standing in this diner because they needed them to be yelling and the energy was necessary.
Get out! Get out! Get out! Get out!
We would cut for scenes and a lot of people would come up to me and be like apologize for doing their job. And I was like, please stop apologizing. It is your job. It is my job. We are all here. We are trying to, you know, make this thing that is feels really important and is really important. And I'm not taking it personally. This is what happened.
And there's a lot of responsibility that comes with getting that right, right? You know, it's like, it's tough to act through it and to be a part of it, but it is important, and you don't want to sort of make it PG if it's not, you know, you want it to feel authentic.
Right. You know, it was really important to me to not shy away from the reality of moments like this for so many people in the 60s. That scene in particular of the cop slamming my head into the counter and then everybody watching. And we did like four or five takes, you know, having to scream for my husband who's being beat up by a cop in front of my eyes and then dragged and taken away for no reason.
The black protesters are swarmed by the cops as Ray is dragged outside. The camera stays close on him, moving with Ray so the audience can see exactly what he's feeling. And that was intentional. The director of photography, Craig Robleski, he wanted it that way.
A lot of the footage that exists of these events is taken at a distance and is observational by virtue of, you know, what they had to do. They couldn't be in the middle of it with a camera. But we could be, and we wanted to immerse the audience in this world and make them feel like they were in that diner and that they were out on that street.
What caught Craig by surprise was how caught up he became in the scene. Shooting it became a little overwhelming.
You know, that scene when Chestnut gets hauled out of the diner and taken into the street, when we shot that, I was so choked up, and I still am now just thinking about it. Because it was, you were just with him and you were just feeling it and you were feeling his fear and his terror and the uncertainty of what was going to happen to him when he was taken out into that street. And it was really, really powerful on the day. And Yusuf's beautiful performance.
We're okay.
What the hell did you say to him? What the hell did you say to him?
I just told him to leave you alone.
There ain't no way in hell that a white cop is just going to walk away because a black woman tells him to.
We don't have... That was a really difficult moment and a really exhausting experience because, you know, Yusuf had all the pads on his back, but they had their like fake nightsticks and were doing the thing and they were doing their jobs and really, you know, trying to get that image caught on camera. It was really, really hard to watch.
And I'm curious, like, you know, having all the experiences you have as a black woman and having all the experiences you have on set, and then looking at what's dominating the news today, like how things feel right now, what is it like to think back on that scene? How does it feel?
You know, I think in the moment, we shot that last summer, a year ago, it still felt present. Like nothing about that felt far away for me. Nothing about black bodies being brutalized by the police felt distant or something that I could not imagine living through, because we were then, we are now, we have been for centuries. It was really important to me to get that right for this show, but also specifically for the civil rights movement, because there are people that are still alive that actually went through that, that were hosed down by fire hoses in the streets, that were chased down by police dogs. Watching the news today is no different than it was watching the news in the 60s. It was not hard for me to research what it is like to be a person of color and feel hunted. It didn't feel like I was having to like reach way back in American history and like unearth these feelings that I couldn't find in myself or in the world that I look around and see today. It is the same thing.
I'm curious, what were the conversations like with Steve Blackman, the DP, or Yusuf about those scenes?
I think we all just wanted to get it right. You know, it felt a little daunting, but also, you know, it felt like good work and important work. Like Netflix is a massive platform. Just how many eyeballs are going to be on these scenes and see, you know, these images and these realities play out in front of them that maybe have never seen anything like that. And granted, that was a year ago. And, you know, the moment that we're in right now, I don't know, there's probably not a country in the world that's not turning on the TV and seeing something very similar play out on their televisions right now.
Of course, Emmy's right. The making of this podcast is run concurrent with protests against systemic racism, happening both nationally and globally, fueled by the murders of Ahmaud Arbery, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Tony McDade, Elijah McClain, and countless other Black Americans. So these conversations and Emmy's storyline feel particularly poignant right now. But like Emmy says, the injustices her character wrestles with have always felt real and immediate for Black Americans. These stories have always been triggering.
Look, as someone that got a chance to watch it, one of my thoughts was sort of like, you know, you see so many things, you see so many of these images in black and white, and it's crazy to watch it and, you know, like 4K HD color. And it was just, you did an amazing, amazing job.
I still have a hard time watching it because I, you know, every actor is like, I could have done more. Like, there's so much to tell. You know what I mean? There's so much to cover and so much that needs to be understood, and there are so many more lessons and experiences to share about that time period.
Look, I know that we have to wrap now, but thank you so much. I know that the talk was sort of heavy, but I appreciate you going there with us.
It's I am kind of expecting this because of what is happening in our country right now, and you know, there is a direct correlation between, you know, my storyline this season and what's going on now and what's been going on for centuries. And so I'm expecting that, but I'm glad that it is a part of the show. And I'm honored that I got to just, you know, brush the surface of what it was like to be a woman of color in the 60s in Texas and to even try to shed a little bit of light, you know, to a broader audience is, you know, it's an honor.